Good morning and happy Sabbath, everyone. We're so grateful that you could join us this morning in our praise and worship. Our first song this morning is going to be number 422, Marching to Zion. Like the woman at the well, we are seeking. 493, fill my cup, Lord.
Things that could not satisfy.
before we begin the service is number 602 in the hymn book, O Brother, Be Faithful. O Brother, Be Faithful, soon Jesus will come. We will be singing the first and the last verse. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. What a wonderful promise and a reminder that we have to sing about this morning. Please join us in singing number 522, My Hope is Built on Nothing Less.
Sand, all of the ground is sinking sand. Good morning and happy Sabbath. I want to welcome everyone to worship service with us today. Everyone who is here in the sanctuary with us and also everyone who is worshiping with us online. Hopefully right now, but one of the beauties of our online worship service is they can worship at any time. And so we welcome you for joining our worship service here today. You know, this past month, this month of October, has been Pastor Appreciation Month. And the Bible is quite clear that we are to be appreciative, to say thank you. There are a number of verses that speak to this, but I'd like to highlight just two. Psalm 118:1 says, "Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever." And one other text that I'd like to read is found in 2 Thessalonians 1:3, and this reads, "We are bound to thank God always for you, brethren, as it is fitting, because your faith grows exceedingly, and the love of every one of you all abounds toward each other." And so what I see in these two texts is that we are to give thanks for God, and we are also to give thanks for one another. And as I said, this month is Pastor Appreciation Month, and this Sabbath we've set aside as kind of a high Sabbath of really showing our appreciation to Pastor Mike. Now, fittingly, the General Conference, the world headquarters of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, has published a couple of articles recently, kind of having to do with pastor appreciation. And just this last week, the Department of Adventist Statistics and Research published an article that looked at some of the attributes that church members really appreciate in their pastors. And Pastor Mike exhibits several of these attributes, but just to name three, is a sample of the attributes, is attributes that people really appreciate in the pastors, is strong leadership, strong decisive leadership, a willingness to give one's whole self to the church and to their ministry, and biblical preaching. And I think that we can all agree that these are definitely traits that Pastor Mike holds, and we very much appreciate that for in him, as well as the other traits that he also exhibits. Now, many people this recently have sent in notes of appreciation, and I understand that some of these are going to be read and presented to Pastor Mike. Just want to point out that if you haven't had the opportunity or haven't taken the opportunity to send in notes of appreciation, you can still do that. You can send Pastor Mike an email, or if you're watching this worship service online, Facebook or YouTube or however you're doing it, there's a comment section, and we encourage you to leave your notes of appreciation for Pastor Mike there. So we also want to thank God for the ministry that Pastor Mike has and bring to him our prayer requests. And we have several requests here today. So I invite you all to bow your heads and pray with me as we seek the throne of grace. Dear Heavenly Father, we are just so thankful that we can be here on this beautiful Sabbath day, that we can take time to commemorate the creation and also the restoration that you provide through your Son, Jesus Christ. We pray that you be with each one of us here and help us to draw closer to you. We pray for your Holy Spirit to be filling this sanctuary and the temple of our bodies, wherever we are, and worshiping you. And Lord, we lift up to you some specific prayer requests. We lift up the Welch's family who've experienced the loss of their parents recently. Be with them and comfort them, Lord, during this time of mourning. We pray that you be with Winetta and her family, with Swinthia and their family. We pray that you be with Dr. Ed Poy. We pray that you be with Calvin and help him with the difficulties he's having with his eyesight. We pray that you be with Miss Sophia and her daughter, and Miss Gloria as well, Lord. You know what is her needs, and we just pray that you reach out to her and comfort her. We pray that you be with Miss Annabelle and the loss of her father. And we pray that you be with Mr. Kiondo, who's traveling and needing of your protection. Lord, you know what each one of these individuals need, and we pray that you'll reach out to them and comfort them and let them know that you are a loving and caring God. Lord, we also pray that you continue to be with the World Church. Right now, many meetings are taking place and planning for upcoming series of evangelism and outreach and strategies for the church, and we just pray that you would be with all those world leaders that are partaking in those meetings. And Lord, we also pray that you be with Quinn Milliken, and we just thank you for being with him and answering his prayer. He's praising you, Lord, for the healing that he's received, And we just thank you for letting them know that you were there with them. Lord, be with us now as we enter in this time of worship. Be with Pastor Mike, who has a divine worship service and message for us today. May it touch our hearts and help us draw closer to you. We pray these things in Jesus Christ's name. Amen.
Good morning, boys and girls. I have a story for you today about a gardener. And one day, a gardener went out into his garden and he planted some seeds. And every day, he very carefully tended his seeds. He made sure that they had plenty of water, plenty of sunlight. He sheltered them from too much heat, and he pulled all the weeds from around his seeds because he wanted them to grow and grow beautiful. And he came out one day, and there were little seedlings coming up through the dirt. And he waited, and he waited, and he carefully took care of all the seeds, and he came out, and they had produced lots and lots of fruit all over the vines, pumpkins. And he looked out and he was so pleased and he said, "It is good." So the gardener went out one day and he picked a very special pumpkin and he brought it inside. But the pumpkin was kind of dirty from laying outside in the dirt. So he took a rag and he cleaned off his pumpkin and he thought, "Oh, okay, now it's clean on the outside. What about the inside of the pumpkin? Has anybody ever carved a pumpkin before? What's on the inside of the pumpkin? Let's find out." So he very carefully cut off the top of the pumpkin. Inside the pumpkin was some really slimy, yucky goo. So let's take all of that goo. Okay. There, that's better. Now the pumpkin was clean on the outside and on the inside. The gardener, he looked at his pumpkin and he said, "It's still needs something." So he decided he was going to cut out a face. Let's take that back off. So he very carefully cut out and a mouth. Still wasn't satisfied with the pumpkin. What else did the gardener need inside his pumpkin? The gardener decided his pumpkin needed a light. So he put a light inside his pumpkin. The pumpkin glowed so beautifully, the gardener's special project was complete. When friends and neighbors saw the gardener's special pumpkin, they marveled at how he took something so dirty and ordinary from his garden, cleaned it inside and out, put his light inside. Boys and girls, we are like the pumpkins, and God is like the gardener. God creates us, and he cares for us, and he chooses us from all the other pumpkins. Goo, just like what was inside the pumpkin, sin. In Romans 3:23, it says, "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." Just like the gardener cleaned out the pumpkin's goo, God wants to clean out all of our sin too. So he sent his son Jesus to die for our sins, to take the punishment that we deserved. It says in Romans 5, verse 8, "But God demonstrates his own love for us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Just like the gardener gave his pumpkin a new face, God makes us a new creation. In 2 Corinthians 5:17, it says, "Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creature. The old things passed away. Behold, new things have come." Just like the gardener put his light into the pumpkin to make it shine, so God gives us his light to shine through us. In Matthew 5:16, it says, "Let your light shine before men in such a way that they may see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven." So when we let God clean out our sin by believing that Jesus died for us and paid the punishment that we deserve, he turns us into new creations so that we can shine for him. And when others see our light, they might want to learn how to have a light of their own too. Thank you. You may go back to your seats.
Is there something I need to do? Oh, thank you. It's now time for the offering, and I don't know if I can speak to, I don't see anything that reminds me. Oh, by which means we can do this. So we have quite a few options, but what we want to remember is that we're returning a faithful tithe and offerings, especially operating offerings for the operating expenses of the church. We do know that the church continues to function and that there are expenses that must be met ever so often. We have the option of going online, which sometimes I have a problem with, to reachinghearts.org. And that is very convenient, but sometimes I have a glitch. So sometimes I return my offerings right here. And if we need to mail the offering, we can do so at 6100 Brooklyn Bridge Road, Laurel, Maryland, 20707. So there is no reason, if we're intentional about what we're supposed to do, to honor God and also to help this building to operate. Will you bow your heads with me? Father in heaven, we thank you so much that you are perfect in all your ways and you do not fail in whatever you have instructed us to do. Help us to remain faithful. Help us that whatever we have, we will return to you faithfully and joyfully, because we need these funds to go far and wide, not only locally, but around the world, the four corners of the earth, because we so expect Jesus to come soon and very soon, especially, Lord, now that we're experiencing challenges in the world, but we do know that the world the word must reach every person in the world before Jesus comes. So I pray now that as we return our tithes and offerings and those who are online, to do so faithfully, because Father, we want to honor and glorify you in all that we do. I ask these things in the name of Jesus, and for his sake we pray. Amen.
Happy Sabbath, church. Today's scripture reading is taken from Romans chapter 4, verses 15 to 18. Because the law brings about wrath, for where there is no law, there is no transgression. Therefore, it is of faith that it might be according to grace, so that the promise might be sure to all the seed, not only to those who are of the law, but also to those who are of the faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all. As it is written, I have made you a father of many nations, in the presence of him whom he believed, God, who gives life to the dead and calls those things which do not exist as though they did, who contrary to hope, in hope believed, so that he became the father of many nations, according to what was spoken, so shall your descendants be. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of his word.
Before we get into our pastoral appreciation celebration, I have a very important announcement for the church. I'd like to have each of you take note of this, and if you need to write this down, I encourage you to do so. November 15, Sunday, November 15, at 3 p.m., at RHI Church, we will be having a very important business meeting. All RHI members are invited to attend this meeting in person on November 15 at 3 o'clock in the church. More announcements will be made regarding this, but I wanted you to take note of this so that you can get it on your calendar. Today, as we've announced previously, we are celebrating Pastoral Appreciation Day. And we are going to do this in our own way. We are not going to rush it, because I think everybody will agree with me when I say that we should have pastoral appreciation more often than once in a blue month. Would you agree with me? I think you would. However, today happens to be Blue Moon Day, and tonight's moon is going to be a blue moon. A blue moon occurs when there are two full moons in the same calendar month, as is the case in October 2020. So tonight we'll be celebrating a blue moon, but I want to assure you that we want to make pastoral appreciation more often than a blue moon. So we are going to take our time and do that today. And I'd like to invite Pastor Mike and Diana to come forward. And following them, I'd like Elder Tim and Sister Dimpui Schaefer to come up here and assist me with pastoral appreciation. Dr. Schaefer, if you would come up, I'd like you to present this bouquet of flowers from the church to Diana as a token of our appreciation for her role in the church. Thank you. You may be seated if you want. Elder Tim, if you would come and take care of the first part, then I will come and join and we'll finish our celebration.
Well, good morning. We have a number of people who have expressed personal appreciation to Pastor Mike and his family that would like to do so in a public way. Some of them I will read here, and some of them have made videos that you'll be seeing. I'm going to start with one that just came in from the Dom family. The first portion is from John. Dear Pastor Mike and Dana, Jamie and I are so grateful that God brought you into our lives. I tell Jamie that our friendship with you, that our friendship and your guidance, counsel, wisdom, and commitment to teaching us the Word of God was God ordained. We know God brought us together to serve a greater purpose in sharing prophetic truth across the globe at the present time. We are forever indebted to the investment you made in our lives. Love in Christ, John. And then the second portion, thank you for everything you have done and continue to do. More than any other person in our adult life, you have dramatically altered it for the better. Because of you, we are now a family with a ministry of our own. You and Diana are incredibly dear to us, and we thank you both every day. Love, Jamie and Tirza.
Ephesians chapter 4, verses 7, 11, and 12. But unto every one of us is given grace according to the measure of the gift of Christ. And he gave some apostles, and some prophets, and some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers for the perfecting of the saints of the work of the ministry and for the edifying of the body of Christ. Happy Pastor Appreciation Month, Pastor Mike.
This one is from Pastor John Thomas. Dear pastoral team, we want to express our deepest appreciation for your personal care of the church members. We live in a time when personal touch is rapidly fading, and so many pastors don't even give out their numbers, but you are very engaged in pastoral care. Thank you. Pastor Mike, you even reached out to us after we moved to Texas to see how we were doing and made it a matter of prayer to hold up Nancy when she was suffering from COVID for several months. Thank you for being a caring and engaged church team.
Hello, Pastor Mike and Diana. Thank you very much for being the pastoral couple for us. While we've been connected to several different churches, we've really appreciated the blessings that we've had with RHI, particularly during the pandemic time. Thank you, Pastor Mike. You had a good balance of keeping things safe, even with the COVID situation, but also making sure we still, us young adults, we still had a place to be. We still were able to have Bible study, and even being able to meet sometimes in person and have that meal together, as well as, of course, you know, the bonfire we had, you know, last week or so. So we really appreciate what you've done in your leadership there, and really your heart that you have for young adults.
Yes, thank you. And I really appreciate everything you have done for us. The Bible studies, the bonfire has been a really big, tremendous blessing to both of us. And I really appreciate everything that you have done, and Diana. And I also enjoy the Sabbath afternoon walks that RHI have been doing as well. I have been greatly blessed by it, by the fellowship and the exercise and the fresh air. As for churches, you know, that have handled the pandemic and found ways to work around things, I think you and Diana have done an amazing job. And I just want to really encourage you guys for doing this. And I, you know, and thank you.
Member of the Community Night Bible Study by the name of Lena Calabrese has this to say. Thank you for the extraordinary work you do encouraging and guiding us in the principles of God. I really appreciate you sharing your time to teach the scriptures and to pray with us. Because of you, I've learned many teachings from God. Thank you for choosing to follow God's calling. From Jeremiah 3:15, she quotes, "And I will give you pastors according to my own heart, which shall feed you with knowledge and understanding." May the Lord continue to strengthen and empower you in the name of his beloved Son, Jesus Christ.
Pastor Mike and Diana. This is Yulon. Here's Sam. Thank you so much, Pastor Mike, for all your Bible studies. Thank you so much for teaching us about Daniel. I learned so much. It's been extremely amazing and insightful. I've gained so much wisdom. Thank you for all the dinners you've done for us. Thank you for all the meals you've cooked for us. Thank you for organizing the bonfire. I really enjoyed it. Thank you, Diana, for your enthusiasm and energy when it comes to the young adult hikes. I really love your company, and thank you for all the walks and the dinners. Thank you so much for you both. You guys have been extremely supportive of young people.
Hey, Mr. and Mrs. Axatengo. This is Sam from New York. I just want to say thank you for your hospitality. Even as a visitor, I feel the warmth that this church provides, not only to the members, but to the young adults, and that means a lot. And of course, to you, Diana, for giving us rides to all the different parks, and of course, to you, Pastor. I remember the first sermon that you talked about from a verse coming from Matthew, where the woman's talking to Jesus and saying, "Lord, help me." I think that, for me, took a different spin on how I look at that story, and I appreciate those moments and everything you have done and you are doing and you will do for us young adults. We really appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you.
I have two more letters, both from members of the Monday night Bible study. Deborah Young has this to say: "I really don't know where to begin. When Lena asked me if I would be interested in doing a Bible study with her, I was a bit hesitant. I wasn't sure I wanted someone inserting their own beliefs into a Bible study, as is often the case. I didn't know enough about the Bible to feel confident in negating any personal beliefs versus Bible truths. Well, that changed when we met Pastor Mike. I would like to thank him today. What a wonderful teacher the Lord has brought into my life. He has taught us all so much about the Bible and Jesus. He is patient with our questions, knowledgeable beyond belief, and encourages us to keep learning about this marvelous book. I really feel so blessed to be part of your group. Thank you for allowing me to join. Thank you for teaching the Bible truths, and thank you for your prayers and positivity. I don't know how else I can show my appreciation for all you do and the sacrifice your wife has made in letting us have Bible study time together. Then to continue donating to your church. It is a small thank you, but from my heart. Please continue to reach out to hearts so that all may have the opportunity to learn from you and bring Jesus into their lives and be saved. Thank you so much." And finally, another Bible study member, Yvonne Kinney. "I would like to sincerely thank Pastor Mike for his devoted time and energy to share the Word of God through the community Monday night Bible study. I have learned so much about the prophecy of Jesus' second coming, the end of days, and the history of God's people. Pastor Mike is a biblical expert and makes it easy to understand the Bible, provides multiple references, and confirms that the Lord is ordering my steps. He expresses concern for each member, and it is through grace and mercy I thank God for this opportunity. Pastor Mike is a true man of God. Be blessed and sincerely appreciated for your service to the community." From Yvonne Kinney.
Hey, Pastor Mike and Miss Diana. We appreciate you guys so much in the ministry you do, especially to those of us who are new, and taking us in and involving us in your ministry, and also just reaching out to young adults and the way that you interact with them. And we really appreciate it.
Hi, Pastor Mike and Miss Diana. I want to thank you all for these years of dedicated service for the new and the old, especially, you know, for the youth that you've taken on this past year. I appreciate, Pastor Mike, all the good food you cook for us. I never knew you were such a good cook. And for Miss Diana, for all the rides and the conversations you have with us. I really appreciate it. God bless you all.
Hi, Pastor Mike. Hi, Miss Diana. Thank you for your warm welcome as I joined midweek just like a month ago. Thank you for having me. Thank you for giving me such a blessing to be at this church, and hopefully I can stay here as long as I can.
The Kopic family has this to say: "Thank you for all your hard work, long hours, and personal sacrifices that you have made shepherding the RHI flock. You are truly dedicated to serving God, serving your church members, and reaching all you can with the gospel message of Jesus Christ. May God continue to bless you and Diana in your ongoing ministry." from the Coppock family.
I want to thank everyone who took time to send in their tributes. I know there were several people who sent personal tributes directly to Pastor Oxentenko and his wife, and we appreciate that too. But we wanted to have one pastoral appreciation from everybody on behalf of the whole church. And so our last tribute is called A Sweet Pastoral Appreciation. And the word sweet is a tip-off because I would like you to see how many candy bars you can recognize in this tribute.
A sweet pastoral appreciation. You can Twix through the Milky Way, or you can orbit planet Mars, but you will not find a more bueno couple than Pastor Mike and Diana Oxentenko. They don't act like they live on Fifth Avenue. What a payday when RHI attracted them to our church. They have proved to be lifesavers. What they have given us is good and plenty. Even if we paid them $100,000 each, it would not be too much for the extra they do. Why Pastor Mike or Diana think nothing of cleaning the halls of the church. Their two sons are definitely not airheads or nerds. Neither has a butterfinger, so they can score a bullseye every time. They are sure to bag whoppers soon. Along the journey, we've had chuckles, snickers, skittles, and a starburst or two. We've also shared a crunch and a sour patch now and then, and even a gobstopper. But we've had mounds of fun, so much almond joy, and zero regrets. We wish you God's blessings as you continue your ministry here. Hugs and kisses from your whatchamacallit church family.
The pastoral team is a large team in the church. It includes all of the elders, and I would like the elders to stand and be recognized at this time. Elders, if you would stand. And in a larger sense, it includes every one of you. Each one of you is a member of the pastoral team, because Pastor Mike expects, and the Bible has said, that all of us should be willing to share the gospel and share our light. So at this time, I'm going to have a special prayer for the pastoral team, which includes each member, whether you're here in person or you're sitting in your living rooms watching this service. We want you to feel a part of being the pastoral team as you share your light and we carry out the mission of this church. So at this time, I would like to offer this special prayer. Eternal God, how privileged we are to belong to the church. Father, we are told that you have placed your special favor on this institution. And it is a privilege for us to belong to this. Father, you have placed pastors to shepherd the flock, to lead out in the mission of the church. We are so happy for Pastor Mike and Diana, the elders, and the other pastors who serve in our midst. Lord, I also include every member in this team, because all of us need to carry out the mission of the church, and that makes us part of the pastoral team. We are so happy that we can serve you in this capacity. Lord, we don't fear the future. We just fear not staying with you and recounting your blessings as we continue in the future. So, Lord, at this time, with all the uncertainty that lies around us, may we place our trust in you and follow you implicitly so that you will carry us through all the challenges that we are going to be faced. And one day, Lord, may we be with you in the home that you've prepared for us, where we can share all the challenges that we've had and all the rewards that we've enjoyed and all the blessings that you have showered upon each one of us. May that be the experience of everybody in this church. I ask in the name of Jesus, amen. Pastor Mike and Diana, if you want to say a few words, you're welcome to do so at this time.
Diana was asking, we take our masks off. She said, not until we speak. We're following the rules around here. Honey, come up here. I don't have to socially distance from you. I just want to say thank you so much. We love you, and the most important thing in our lives is this church, minus God and our children, who are prominent. And literally, we would give our lives for this church and for you, and we're not just saying that. And I'm deeply moved by your love for us. We always want to direct any kind of appreciation to Jesus. We owe everything to him. It's a miracle we stand in this building. What we've been through, all of us have been through, and some as of late, only heaven knows. It's a miracle we have the building. Hey, Andrew, we're getting a little feedback on this. Just pull back a little bit, just a little bit. Thank you. And I'm just grateful for Bob, Andrew, who worked back there, for everyone. But there's a person here who needs to be recognized, who was not recognized, but it's my role to recognize her. How many of you have noticed that we have stellar prayer meetings at Reaching Hearts? And Dr. Dimpuy Schaefer, with Andy Schaefer, head deacon, really pulled that off so he can go online. I'm growing in the Lord, and there's a spiritual revival occurring here because Dr. Schaefer is using her ministerial gifts. She taught ministers for 20 years at Spicer University in the Adventist Church. And we're just very grateful to have you here. I want you to know that. And we're recognizing you as well. But I just want to let you know we love you. And I've said it three times, and my wife would say, honey, you're going circular. Honey, you can talk. Go ahead. But we do. We love you.
I don't know what to say because I wasn't expecting to say anything, but let me just say thank you. It's a wonderful privilege to be here at this church. Your love for us, for our family, your partnership in ministry, your desire to reach out, and your commitment is all extraordinary. And so I just want to say thank you. Thank you for everything. And thank the Lord that he brought us all together.
Something just hit me here. There's a couple of other names I want to mention. Pastor Del Santos, who has ministered and preached here. Pastor Gary Blanchard. Our general conference and retired ministers who frequent here. They're just as much a part of our pastoral team as my wife and I are. And we want to say thank you very much for all of you. God bless you.
Counselor, comforter, keeper.
Happy Sabbath. So good to see you guys here and socially distancing, but here, isn't that cool? That we, and those that can't be here and have good reason not to be here, you're here too because of technology and the power of God. Just a couple of things here before we get launched, we launch in. Thanks for taking my cell phone. If I bring my cell phone up here, I'll get a call. I've gotten two calls this morning during the service, and they were very good ones. They said, Pastor Mike, we can't hear on the internet. It was YouTube. If that should ever happen in the future, you just go ahead and text me and call me, or Bob Rova. And Bob, it might be good to put your phone number up there at some point so that Bob had to reinitialize the system for it to work in YouTube. Many churches across the country have had that problem from time to time. So he quickly addressed it, and that helps us. So thank you for texting me, calling me. That's why I had to get up a couple of times here. But this is kind of exciting. We're living in world-changing times, and we're adapting, aren't we? And God's working with us. And my wife always likes an adventure. She's a very independent soul. She's dragged half the church's young people around the world. And so I wanted to walk her down the steps here, but she's confident to walk down herself. But I love my wife, and I just want to say, where are you at, Diana? She's out there at the door again, taking temperatures. But they've opened the door so I can see right through the doors. I see her the whole time, and she can hear me. So thank you, honey. Let's bow our heads and pray. Dear Father God, we are grateful that our hopes do not have to be at war with someone else's hopes because we're different if we put our hope in Jesus. So guide us today to know the Word of God, to live it, and to be true to you at all times, and to be kind, good Christians. In Jesus' name, amen. Alexander Dumas once wrote, "All human experience is summed up in two words, wait and hope." Now, that, of course, reminds me of Revelation 14:12. Here's the patience of the saints. Here are those who keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. Wait and hope. We share today in the blessed hope of Jesus' soon return. I am looking forward to a kingdom that is not made of men's designs, of men's power, but is shaped by the living Christ for all eternity. Are you with me in there? I want to go home to glory to live with Jesus. In this world, we wait when we want to fix it right now, but we can't. We wait when the time is not right just yet. We wait when it looks like a solution is long in coming and the possibility of fixing it is unlikely. So we just wait and we kind of grind our teeth or whatever. We often wait when we feel powerless because if you can't do anything, what do? You wait. And when we wait, and we wait when life and circumstances seem out of control by all the trouble that seems to win all around, so the waiting person can feel like they're in prison. As Christians, we are waiting for the coming of Jesus Christ. How many of you like that part? The waiting, maybe not, but the coming of Christ. We are waiting for God to intervene and save us at the end of the age. We are waiting for a world that is coming that is a good world, so we don't have to settle down here anymore and put up with the awful state of affairs of fear and greed and chaos in this world. And when we wait, we have to believe deep inside. I mean really believe. Not fake faith, but real faith. To believe deep inside that God will make His promises good in our lives in the end. That He will finish the work He started. I don't know about you. There have been times in my life when I struggled with my own failures, when I fell away from God for a little bit. Has anybody else here, have you had a time when you lapsed spiritually? And I have noticed this, and this is what has come into me, that my good shepherd King took care of me to shepherd me through that little detour like He did Abraham when he went to Egypt. And that our God is immensely interested, committed to getting us through so that we make it into His eternal kingdom. And so I am grateful for a shepherd King who gets the job done. And so He knows how to finish the work in us. He knows how to help us wait. And so Jesus said, the one who endures to the end will be saved. Didn't say might be saved, will be saved. Psalms 37:34 makes sense to me right now, especially before this election. Psalms 37:34, wait for the Lord and keep to his ways, and he will exalt you to possess the land. You will look on the destruction of the wicked. In the Bible, the righteous live by faith like Habakkuk. You know, he got up there and watchtower. He saw the injustice of the Babylonians coming in to take out Jerusalem. He thought, Lord, and begin to pray like we do. Lord, I want a little social justice here. Why on earth are you allowing a nation more evil than we have been to come and discipline us and to take us into captivity? Why do you do it that way? Of course, the Lord spoke to him and said, listen, I'm not going to give you all the answers. I'm going to give you a vision. And I want you to run with that vision. But here's the essence of the vision. The just shall live by faith. You live by faith, I'm going to get you through. You don't have the answers, but you hang on to me by faith, I'm going to hang on to you. I have a purpose that you are not aware of. And so there are times when we don't see the justice that God has in the injustice of the world all around us. And Habakkuk struggled with that. But as Christians, we have learned to lay our fears and our hopes at the feet of Jesus. So we don't demand justice as Christians. We don't. We wait for it on God's terms. We wait for it with Jesus as our shepherd king. We wait for it, and yes, we painfully endure the process until the kingdom of God is revealed. An amazing statement is found in The Desire of Ages, page 509. Kind of small type there. I hope you can see it on the TV screen. The servant of the Lord to the remnant church said this: the government under which Jesus lived was corrupt and oppressive on every hand. We're crying abuses, extortion, intolerance, and grinding cruelty. Yet the Savior attempted no civil reforms. He attacked no national abuses, nor condemned the national enemies. He did not interfere with the authority or administration of those in power. He who was our example kept aloof from earthly governments, not because he was indifferent to the woes of men, but because the remedy did not lie in merely human and external measures. To be efficient, the cure must reach men individually and must regenerate the heart. Christ was on a mission to bring the justice and mercy of God into my personal life and your personal life, thus to create the Christian church and by the salt of the earth to transform the world, but not by revolution. I have noticed that today it's Halloween. How many of you have noticed today's Halloween? I'm not going to say happy Halloween to you because I don't like the day. I like to stay as far away from it as possible. We don't hallow it as a Christian holiday, thank goodness. It has its roots in Satanism and other things. But, you know, we also aren't rude about it. We know that when kids come to my door, I give them some candy. But not on COVID, I'm not giving anybody anything at my door this year. They'll have to get it from mommy and daddy. But we don't celebrate Halloween in the church. We don't have Halloween parties in our church. We might have prayer meetings. We might get together to have something that's a Christian option. It just so happens that the Holy Sabbath day is today, and it falls on Halloween, October 31. Am I right? So there's something good about it today. Good things can happen on Halloween because we're in church and we're worshiping God, and we can forget the Halloween part. This day in history, Martin Luther King nailed his 95 theses to the church door in Wittenberg. It was the castle church door of Wittenberg in the year 1517 that started the Reformation, that gave us sola scriptura, the Bible and the Bible only, the teaching of Christ our righteousness by grace alone. A good thing happened that day on Halloween. And this year has been a strange one for me. It's been a Halloween kind of year. But it can be a good year, and here's how it can be a good year. If we keep our eyes on Jesus Christ, this can be a great year. This does not have to be the down year in your life. It doesn't have to be the year it all went wrong. It can be the year you can say, well, you know what? In the middle of that COVID process, we found a way to obey the laws of the land, to figure out how to fellowship, to obey Hebrews 10 that says don't forsake, either through technology or being outdoors. We found a way to use the Zoom connection that Brother Scott has been mentioning to reach out and evangelize and to encourage and nurture the church. We found a way because God was in us working to his will. This has been a great year. In fact, I have seen more spiritual growth in our church this year than last year because of the crises. I can't hear every amen out there on the internet, but I'm going to say amen to that. Praise God. We have seen fear, we have felt it, but by God's grace, by the promises of the Bible, we have overcome the fear in the power of the Lord. It's been a great year. We have seen good people with different points of view. Now I'm going to move out into the broader culture, outside of the church. We've seen good people with different points of view, from different perspectives, keeping silent because they are afraid to speak out. We are living in an era of intolerance from every direction. The loud and the angry dominate the civil discourse on the right and the left these days. And it looks like hatred has the upper hand in the world and in our country. Have you noticed that? That we're living a harsh time in world culture, American culture. The election, how many of you know the election is coming up here November 3? How many of you have already voted? I went and voted yesterday. I don't plan to go through. In fact, it took me 5 minutes to go through and vote right here in Burtonsville, Maryland. I said, honey, you should have gone and voted with me. She likes going to vote on November 3 so it can affect the statistics she stays up to watch. And she makes sure I stay up on election night, and so it's popcorn and whatever. And all right, the election will be this coming Tuesday, November 3, and people on both sides of the political spectrum, with some in the middle, moving to the right or the left, are hoping to win to save the country. No, you can't miss that. This is the most engaging election in my lifetime. It's really a mirror of the Civil War days in terms of the division in our country. Democrats are hoping, and Republicans are also hoping, that they will win. And when they win, everything will be okay because the other side lost. That seems to be the feeling that I hear in the news. We win, the other side loses, we save our country for what we think it should be. Hope is at war with hope. I mean, hope is at war with hope right now in our country. We see people with strong hopes on this side, people with strong hopes on that side, and it's hope against hope. The right and the left offer their own remedies on how to fix the country. And because we place our hope in Jesus Christ as Christians who believe in the prophetic message of God, we are caught as Christians in the arena of the world as we wait for the blessed hope of Jesus' soon return. Now, that's the one I'm focusing on. I'm focusing on the hope that is true in Jesus. So hope is against hope this year. We'd be blind to ignore it. We would be ignorant to fail to perceive it as a fact. As a pastor of the gospel, I have some real concerns today that I want to talk to you about. Can I talk to you about my real concerns as I pray through things and not get to the heart of what I'm concerned about? I think the Lord has put this on my heart, but I want to test it by Scripture. As I get older, and I am getting older, I thought someone might say, amen, I'm getting older. As I have more gray on my hair on my head and less hair also, maybe I'm a little wiser than I was when I was a young pastor. Maybe I'm not. I started ministry when I was 24. I'm 58. What's the math there? 34 years in ministry. Maybe I'm wiser, maybe I'm not. But I've experienced a lot of conflict in my life. In fact, I've compared my ministry with other Adventist ministers, and I think I've had more conflict than any pastor I've ever interacted with, for whatever reason. I don't desire conflict. It's not in my DNA. But I think early on I was taught by the example of godly pastors to stand for the right though the heavens fall, that famous statement in the spirit of prophecy. And when you're a young man, you read a statement like that, you have a different idea of what it means when you get older and wiser. It takes a lot of energy to do the right thing when justice is on the chopping block, it seems. But I have also learned that when you stand up for the right in the wrong way, you can wrong other people on purpose or accidentally. When you're hot under the collar and fervent about your feelings and you're so sure you're right and you want to make it happen, you can actually commit wrongs with that fervent feeling, that unguided zeal. So it's possible to be right and very wrong. If reason leaves the room because of a hot anger in your heart, you can be right and very wrong. Maybe that's what I've learned as I've gotten older. I can remember the times when I stood for right and did it wrong. When you can't reason and talk things out, you're in the wrong no matter how right you are. Alexander Solzhenitsyn was very clear. In fact, I think I quote him here somewhere. I may have left his quote out of my sermon. But he talks about how if you lose the ability to have civil discourse, If you move to an impassioned protest mentality instead of sitting down and letting the educated reason work things out, your society, your culture has descended into a dangerous place. We are there in the country today. It's very hard to get people from two extremes to sit in the same room and talk things out. Now, the Bible is very clear. God says, come now, let us reason together. God wants his people to be reasonable. He wants his people to look at all the dimensions of the church and realize that every person is important. When you can't reason, you can't talk things out, you're in the wrong, no matter how right you are. It's possible to want what you think is right so badly that you become bad yourself in your pursuit of the right. We sometimes refer to the righteous right. You ever hear that? Well, the righteous right. When you're right, you can be righteous indignation. We refer to the righteous right, but we forget that only Jesus is righteous. So we've got to be very careful not to fall into the trap of saying, well, in my righteous cause, I can do whatever I need to. No, only Jesus is righteous. The pursuit of justice without Jesus is an empty pursuit because Jesus' kind of justice doesn't make sense to the world. At times, it doesn't make sense to us, but it is God's justice. In fact, Romans 3 says, God has provided a righteousness apart from the law. The righteousness that comes through faith in Jesus Christ. That made no sense to the theologians. It made no sense to the students of the law. But it's the righteousness of God that brought Jesus to the cross where the guilty was spared and that the one who was innocent was not spared, where it was turned upside down. And in the mercy mix of justice, kissing mercy at the cross, that makes no sense to the world. We're saved by that. So it's God's righteousness and justice we must seek as Christians. And so it may make no sense to the world, but we got to follow God's sense of justice and righteousness. Jesus started his ministry in Luke 4. Take your Bible and turn with me there. When he came to the synagogue at Nazareth, where he grew up, his home church, he started his home church with his first one-sentence sermon. When I had to preach in my homiletics class at Southern Adventist University, they gave us 30 minutes to preach. Jesus' first sermon was a scripture text and one sentence. And he started a revolution for God with that one sentence. He took the scroll of the gospel prophet Isaiah. He turned and he read it. Luke 4, 18 and 19. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to preach good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. Now, the key word is anointed. It's the word Messiah in the Hebrew word. It's the verbal form of the Mashiach, the Messiah. And so God sent Jesus in this world. He refers to the very verse in Isaiah that would announce the coming of the Messiah. God sent Jesus in this world to bring mercy and justice. How many of you want mercy and justice in your life? I want mercy and justice in my life. I hear and I feel the concerns of people in the streets who want mercy and justice. It has touched my heart. I want it also in a way where you don't inflict injustice and a lack of mercy on people that you're angry at, where the scales are balanced, where the protest is not wrong but righteous. And so I struggle with what I'm seeing. I see a need for converted hearts in our culture, around the world, but in American culture. So this was Jesus' first sermon. It got to the heart of what we're feeling today in our modern culture. He didn't preach much at all. He had more Bible than sermon here, and his sermon, as I said, was only one sentence long. He simply read from the scriptures, which I shared with you, and he said, "Today, this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." That's all he said. And when he said that, he sat down. There were only two seats in the synagogue. One was the seat of Moses, and the other was the seat of Elijah. They're right there near the candlesticks that was on each side of the Torah scroll. He most likely sat down in the seat of Moses because Moses had predicted that the prophet would come and that he would be the Messiah prophet. And when he sat down in that seat, Luke says they were gazing intently at him. And it's an intense word in the Greek language. They knew what it meant. He had read from the scripture that says he's the anointed one. He had sat in the seat of Moses. And that to them was blasphemy. This carpenter boy from Nazareth had with one sentence turned the whole town upside down. And so they got angry in the synagogue of his home church, and they shuffled him out the door to throw him over a cliff and kill him. His first sermon, one sentence. Jesus could have destroyed his enemies that he grew up with a blink of an eye, because there was God in Jesus. But Jesus walked away. Now, this is the part of the story we don't often realize. He walked away from anger because Jesus was all merciful and full of justice and self-control in a way that matters for saving souls. He didn't engage the mob. He walked away. And that mob was made up of people he had known all his life. He recognized the worth of every person. Jesus came to preach good news for his people in the world. Jesus came to set people free. He came to bring hope to the poor and the oppressed of Satan. Jesus came to make people free on the inside where it matters most. I say this based on Scripture. You can have chains on your hands, but if you are free in your heart because of Jesus, you are a slave to no man or woman. When you have to defend your rights at such a heavy level, you are showing that you are really a slave in the soul where Christ can make you free. We are told by the servant of the Lord that Jesus did not contend for his rights. We all wait in a world and we suffer injustice. We feel its heavy hand. Where hope is at war with hope, as I mentioned, the two groups hoping for different things, where the right and the left are at war with each other with their own version of a solution that doesn't work in the end. Friend, Jesus came to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord for us all. Not the Sadducees, not the Pharisees, of the Lord. If Jesus shows up in your life this year, I want to tell you, based on the authority of the Word of God, it's a good year for you. If Christ shows up for you, no matter what you're going through, if you gain a deeper relationship with Jesus, this is a good year. It is the acceptable year of the Lord. The world may be falling apart all around you, and you may be in a whole heap of trouble. Your finances may be in trouble. Your job may not be there. But if you are getting closer to God because of this COVID-19 crisis, it is the acceptable year of the Lord's favor. And the prognosticators and the experts may think that you're running out of time, that you can have no hope, this is the way it's going to be forever. But if Jesus shows up in your life this year, friend, it's a good year for you because it is the acceptable year of the Lord's favor, the Jubilee year for you, when you can be set free. The prophet Daniel reveals that when Jesus comes, there is going to be a time of trouble worse than anything the world has ever known. Christ affirms it in Matthew 24. And when it gets real bad, worse than now, I mean, it's bad now, but worse than now, so that we can't live here anymore or we will die in a single day. When it gets that bad, it will once again be the acceptable year of the Lord because Jesus is coming to save his people. We have the blessed hope of the second coming of Christ, and to that end, the church is mobilized. The prophet Daniel describes the atmosphere of anger that leads to the final death decree. Yes, a death decree at the very end of time that will be the event that will marshal the second coming of Christ. And through anger, the king of the north will marshal his forces. King of the North representing the coalition of all global power. The secular King of the South will be absorbed into the global King of the North, which will represent a coalition of power where the harlot rides the beast in the book of Revelation. And when that occurs, the commandment keeping people of God will have no place left on earth anymore. And Jesus will come. It is the end. Look at Daniel 11:44 and 45. And tidings from the east and the north shall alarm him, the king of the north. Now, what is that? The tidings from the east and the north represent the gospel tidings that go to the world at the very time of the end. They are prophetic tidings. The first, the second, and the third angel's message, followed by the fourth angel, Revelation 18:1, that illumines the whole world with its glory. It will be a Based on Revelation 14, it will be an assertion of the everlasting gospel in the hour of God's judgment based on the prophecies of Daniel and Revelation. It will be a proclamation that the end time religious system known as Babylon has fallen. The mark of the beast issue, the third angel's message, will draw special attention to the Sabbath of the fourth commandment, not as an arbitrary day to keep, but as the sign and seal of the everlasting covenant that brought Jesus to the cross of Calvary, and thus the sign of our Redeemer's rest at the time of the end. The Bible says the worshipers of the beast have no rest day or night, but God's people will have Sabbath rest in Jesus. And so the King of the North, he will hear those tidings, good tidings, because Christ comes right after that in Revelation 14. He comes on a white cloud. And he'll be terrified that his world kingdom order concept will be undermined by the coming of Jesus Christ and the proclamation of it. And he shall go forth, it says in verse 44, with great fury. You know, we've seen that lately. Great fury to exterminate and utterly destroy many. The Hebrew tongue would indicate here to devote to destruction, like Joshua did when he came into the promised land. This Hebrew word, kerem, includes the idea of establishing a new creative order by the destruction of evil in the past, by annihilating the old order to create the new. And so God's people have no place left on earth based on Daniel 11:44. And then verse 45, he, the king of the north, shall pitch his royal palatial tents between the sea, representing the nations of the earth, and the glorious holy mountain, God's holy truth, his sanctuary. God's people, the 144,000, will stand on Mount Zion prophetically. So he puts himself between the people of God and the world, between the holy mountain of God and the world. He's trying to block the way so no one will be saved at the time of the end. And yet it says this, yet he shall come to his end with none to help him. His globalist view, the view of this world power system that coalesces just before Jesus' return, will fail because of Daniel 12, verse 1. There are some people in our church, and I don't want to emphasize this, but I want to bring it out. As I said, I'm preaching to concerns today. There's some people in our church, and some people who have smart credentials, and they think they're so smart that they've set aside the spirit of prophecy that is the testimony of Jesus. I've heard them. I mean, they've explained away the clearest teachings of the book, The Great Controversy. They've argued that we can't really take these books seriously. That's foolhardy. They have said it as something we should avoid. Who needs this? I am telling you right now that the book, The Great Controversy, I would have had one to hold up in my hand today, but I gave it to my sister-in-law yesterday. They visited from Canada. I had a copy of The Great Controversy I was going to bring to church, and I gave it to her. She's a messianic Jewish Christian, and I wanted her to have it with a book from Sabbath to Sunday by Dr. Samuel Bakayoko. But that book, The Great Controversy by Ellen White, is a book that every Christian should read carefully with a humble heart. It is for our time. We are caught in a war between good and evil, and the book, The Great Controversy, is a special gift to God's people at our time. I'm amazed by the accuracy of the fulfillment within that book. The Great Controversy, page 635, chapter 40, God's people delivered on the screen. She describes what happens in the context of Daniel 11, 44 to 45, when the protection of human laws shall be withdrawn from those who honor the law of God. There will be in different lands a simultaneous movement for their destruction. As the time appointed in the decree draws near, now that's what Daniel 11, 44 and 45 is talking about, when the king of the north rushes upon God's people to exterminate them. As the time appointed in the decree draws near, the people will conspire, she means the people of the earth, will conspire to root out the hated sect. That's the remnant church. It will be determined to strike in one night a decisive blow which shall utterly silence the voice of dissent and reproof. That's a death decree that is broad, globally broad. The right and the left will unite at the time of the end to end God's people. You say, Pastor Mike, how do you know that? I know that because that is exactly what they did to Jesus when they crucified him. Jesus' end is a prophetic picture, a typological picture of the time of the end. Christ is eschatology, which means end time, the study of end time events. We study his life, his end that led to the cross, his resurrection, the earthquake, the darkness. It's the time of the end stuff going on right there for him. We can draw from those lessons. So Christ's life illustrates the issues for God's people in the distant future. The Pharisees on the right, they were the super conservatives. The Sadducees on the left, which were the progressive liberals, without Jesus, without God, without a love for God, they conspired together to arrest and crucify Jesus. That's the fact of history. That will happen also at the time of the end of the Mark of the Beast issue. That's why we need to remember that our ultimate loyalty, no matter where we find ourselves in the spectrum of Democrat, Republican, or Libertarian, or whatever, that our ultimate loyalty as Christians is not to an earthly kingdom, an earthly party, but to the kingdom of God. Am I right? I mean, we got to get that straight. She continues. Now, here's Great Controversy. The people of God, some in prison, some in hidden and solitary retreats of the forests and the mountains, still plead for divine protection, while in every quarter, companies of armed men, urged by the hosts of evil angels, are preparing for the work of death. This is the death decree moment, she describes, matching Daniel 11:40-45 perfectly. Friend, if you want to arm yourself at the time of the end to keep yourself safe, and if you are trusting your guns instead of your God, did you hear me? If you're trusting your guns instead of your God, you'll be on the wrong side of things when Jesus comes. Now, I'm not saying you can't have a little target practice. I taught my kids how to shoot a bow and arrow, a 22 at a target. And I have to admit, they took out Bambi later in life and gave it to the homeless shelter and maybe something else on occasion. I never taught them to do that. I taught them to go fishing. But I've also taught them never to trust these things, never to depend on a firearm for the kind of confidence we must always have in God. I am talking about a militant mentality that doesn't trust God to bring the kingdom of God. In the days of Jesus, who were they? They were the Sakara. They were the men of the dagger. They were the militant force in Judaism. I know the term. Doctor, you know what it is. The zealots. They were zealots, but they were called men of the dagger by Josephus. And they wanted to force the kingdom of God with their force of arms. We can have none of that if we are to walk with Jesus correctly. She continues in the book of the Great Controversy. It is now in the hour of utmost extremity that the God of Israel interposed for the deliverance of his chosen, saith the Lord. Ye shall have a song as in the night when a holy solemnity is kept, and gladness of heart as when one goeth to come into the mountain of the Lord, to the mighty one of Israel. And the Lord shall cause his glorious voice to be heard, and shall show the lightning down of his arm with the indignation of his anger, and with the flame of a devouring fire, with scattering and tempest and hailstones. God will fight our battles at the time of the end. We don't have to fight them for ourselves. Daniel describes the same scene and outcome. Take your Bibles, turn to Daniel 12:1. Following Daniel 11:44-45. At that time, key phrase, at that time, that's when the king of the north goes out to destroy God's people. That's when the death decree goes out. That's when the forces of evil surround to annihilate the people of God. At that time shall arise Michael, the great prince who is charge of your people. And there shall be a time of trouble such as never been since there was a nation till that time. But at that time, three times it says this, but at that time, your people, doesn't say maybe, shall be delivered. Everyone whose name shall be found written in the book. What an amazing verse. At that time is the acceptable year of the Lord again at the time of the end. Time runs out for the waiting people of God. God does not run away. God does not escape from them. God finds them at that time. When the nations marshal their armies in the streets of our great cities to destroy the remnant church, God will marshal the armies of heaven with the commander who is Michael, who stands guard over God's people. At that time, Michael in Hebrew means who is just like God? Question. You have to be God and not a created being to answer that question, right? Who is just like God? Daniel calls Michael the great prince. That means he is the son of the Most High God. And Gabriel told Mary in Luke 1:32 that Jesus is the Son of the Most High God. You can't be the great prince above Jesus. Christ is the great prince. And so this is not a created prince. This is the prince who created the universe. This is the prince who has God in him, who came from God, who is just like God, who is the answer to the question, who is just like God? It is Michael who delivers. Now Jude 9 tells us that Michael is the archangel. What does that mean? In Greek it means the ruler of the angels. He is the captain of the Lord's host in the book of Daniel. He is the prince of the host in the book of Daniel. He's the man in linen also. And we know that the commander, the prince of God's army, is the great prince. Christ is here mentioned by the phrase Michael. John Wesley got this correct. John Calvin came pretty close to it. The reformers were on the track to understand Daniel 12 correctly. And so we must never say that Michael is a created being, as our Jehovah's Witness friends do. They simply do not follow the evidence where they should. Michael is God in the form of the great commander of the angels, Jesus, who became God with us in Bethlehem's manger. So God doesn't send a prince to save us at the time of the end. God sends the great prince to save us at the time of the end. There are times when we're all lost. or have been so in life, I have to say that's true for me. There have been times I felt utterly lost, when I didn't know what I was doing, when I felt the pain of my sins, when I could feel that I let God down, myself and others, and you feel like giving up when those times hit you. Friend, and so we hope against hope at times that the world would destroy us, that Jesus will come and save us in spite of us and the world. We live in a world where hope is against hope, and we hope that God will find us when we can't fix it. Have you ever been there? You're there. I've been there. A lot of people are there right now. Joel 2:28, and it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams. Your young men shall see visions. Even upon the men servants and maid servants in those days, I will pour out my spirit. And I will give signs or portents in the heavens, on the earth, blood and fire, and columns of smoke. The sun shall be turned to darkness, the moon to blood, before the great and terrible day of the Lord. That happened when Jesus died. It happens again in end time events. It says, for in Mount Zion and in Jerusalem, there shall be those who escape, as the Lord has said. And among the survivors, or the remnant, it could be translated, shall be those whom the Lord calls. I want to be with Jesus staying on Mount Zion, not standing with any political party at the time of the end. I don't want to be found with any extreme or any human institution that would get my eyes off of Jesus and the hope I have in Christ. Is that valid? Now, that doesn't mean I can't have political ideas. But in the end, we got to lay them at the altar, don't we, and ask Jesus to lead us. Anyone who honestly calls on Jesus' name as Savior will be delivered. That's our hope. Sometimes anyone includes Democrats, Republicans, people in the Libertarian Party. Now, sometimes psychologically, we hope for one thing and we hope for another, and the hopes themselves can be at war with each other. You ever had hopes in conflict in your life? You wanted this, but it didn't match. Abraham hoped against hope that God's word would work so he could have a son. We do the same. I know a lot of people who are Democrats who are hoping, hear me out. I know a lot of people who are Democrats, don't raise your hand, don't say amen, who are hoping to win on November 3 to save and transform our country. Am I right? I know a lot of people who are Republicans who are also hoping to win on November 3 to save and preserve our country. That's a fact. And both groups are hoping to win everything, winner take all, because they want our country to be a good country in how they view it. Wouldn't it be nice to live in a world where everyone wins because everyone cares about each other, so much so that no one pushes their rights on another? Wouldn't that be a great world? We are told by the pen of inspiration that Jesus never contended for his own rights, and yet he worked tirelessly to save every lost soul he met. He said, look out for the leaven of the Sadducees and the Pharisees. When you go to vote this coming Tuesday, how about keeping your vote to yourself, as the servant of the Lord has counseled us to do? How about recognizing that your conscientious vote, which is your privilege and your right, must be different than someone else's conscientious vote, and that we must never judge that person for why they cast their vote, be it different from yours or mine? And how about praying for our country, that God's purpose and plan will be worked out with your vote, and that Jesus' kingdom will come because you did the right thing in silent in the voting booth, and then leave it to God and his son Jesus to figure out how to count the votes, how to make them work for the time of the end, so his will be worked in your life and the world and not yours. What do you say? I'm a registered independent. That's a fact, because I am looking for the King of God in my life and in my time. I have friends who are Democrat, and I love them. And I have friends who are Republicans, and I love them too. I don't tell my Republican friends that I have Democratic friends. I don't tell my Democrat friends I have Republican friends, but I just did. That's risky. But I want to live with both of them in the kingdom of God as brothers and sisters, where we all get along in a kingdom with no parties except Jesus' party. That's where I want to go. I want to live in a church that's full of love, where hate has no place from any quarter. I want to talk about the things of God instead of earthly positions, agendas, ideas and philosophies, earthly leaders who are quickly exchanged, who can go with the whims of time and force. I want to talk about a timeless kingdom where God's righteousness, a crazy kind of righteousness that makes no sense with our justice, that saves us, where God's righteousness in Jesus rules and where his mercy wins, and where because of the cross, your worst enemy who is saved from sin can become your best friend in the end. I want to see love win and no one left behind if they're in the right or in the left. I want to see them all saved. Is that wrong? Is it wrong to care about people on both sides of the equation? On November 3, Election Day, I want to elect Jesus. I want to see Jesus enthroned as my hero and king. I want to elect Jesus. I've already cast my vote in my prayers upon my knees for King Jesus, the Son of the Most High God. We live in an ugly world where hope is against hope, and yet faith is the key that unlocks the door to heaven's kingdom. We put our faith and our hope in Jesus Christ if we make it into God's party at the time of the end. If half of our church is Democrat and half of our church is Republican, half of our church is likely going to be very disappointed a week or so after November 3, because no one's going to know election night this year. It's going to take a week to figure it out, maybe longer. But when they finally figured out who wins, it's very likely half of the church members could be upset, half gloriously happy. Winners and losers. But friends, if you have faith in Jesus, you will know who's the winner. You hear me? God is the one who's going to win because Jesus is coming soon. God is directing human affairs. He's allowing kings to be set up and kings to come down. If you really believe that God is in control of the world and that God is in control of your life, you will not be decimated shortly after Election Day, no matter what the outcome is this year at the voting booth, right? You'll still work for the King of God. You'll love as Jesus loved. I have preached a lengthy sermon or two in the past few weeks at RHI, and I'm a little shorter today. I can sense that a lot of people are tired, and so I want to keep it short and end it right now. So what do you say? I'm going to give you the admonition. Go out and vote this November 3 for Jesus, and keep your vote to yourself that you voted for the country, so that your brother or sister you love in the church will know that you love Jesus, but more importantly, in our church context, they will know the love of Jesus is in you so that you love them too. God bless you, everyone. And don't forget to vote for Jesus. Is that fair enough? Okay, let's stand for our closing song.
Our closing hymn this Sabbath morning is number 214, We Have This Hope. Number 214 in the hymn book, We Have This Hope That Burns Within Our Hearts.
Within our hearts, hope in the coming.
Father, thank you so much that you sent Jesus to love. You sent Jesus to show us justice and mercy in a perfect package, self-control, reason, and compassion. And Father, we are called to model our lives after Jesus in the church. May there be no party spirit here except the party of Jesus. May people be free from every quarter to come and be free from the things outside the door, so that in the church there is an atmosphere of gospel service, an atmosphere of ministry for the lost. Lord, many of us here have political leanings. It's impossible not to have them. But Father, may we not be political in the church. And may we not have political leanings with you. Help us to lean on you as Savior and King, because that you are. And bless every life. Take the fear away from the hearts that are shattered and broken. And may every heart know that in Jesus, we have an anchor that is safe for the soul. And so, Lord, thank you that this is the acceptable year of the Lord's favor. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thirsty.